What's up, faceting friends? Previously, we've looked at different cuts like the step cut, the mix cut, the brilliant cut, and today I wanted to look at something a little bit more modern and something definitely more American, the opposed bar cut, otherwise known as the pixel cut, here on the Gem Cutter's Craft. So here we've got a cut that's had a lot of viral media attention in the last few years, and I thought it'd be kind of fun to look back at the history of this cut and see what are the actual mid-century origins of this cut and what are all the different iterations that it's gone through over the years. So let's go back to the 1940s. There's a gem cutter in San Francisco named Francis Spearison. So Francis Spearison was the original president of the San Francisco Gem and Mineral Society. He helped found it. He was also a professional gem cutter, and in the 1950s, he put out a book called The Art of the Lapidary. So inside the book, we see the first ever variation of what we know as today as the opposed bar cut. So check it out. He shows us several different versions of the cut. Up here, we can see the very typical modern version of the opposed bar cut. So down here, he gives us some different variations on this cut, which he's called the lens cut. So part of the reason why Francis Spearison is still remembered as a gem cutter today is because of his work and his collaboration with Oakland-based jeweler Margaret DePatta. So DePatta was really interested in this idea of bending light. And so in her collaboration with Spearison, they started to utilize this new type of lens cut, which he talks about in his book as being a recent development in 1950. So we can see here in some of the jewelry of Margaret DePatta, the different versions of the lens cuts being utilized. In the oldest version I found from 1941, we can see this is the exact lens cut that Spearison shows us in the book. It's a piece of quartz with a flat bottom, and on the top it's got horizontal lines, which is basically the trademark of the lens cut or the opposed bar cut or the pixel cut, whatever you want to call it. But it starts out very simply with just 8 or 10 straight lines, parallel facets along the crown. There's no pavilion. There's a small girdle just to hold it into the jewelry, and then 2 side facets just to finish the shape. So the idea behind the lens cut is that it bends and distorts light. So if we look at some of the other Margaret DePatta jewelry that uses the lens cut, we can see what Spearison's doing and what DePatta wants to do, which is put a piece of metal or put a piece of the jewelry behind the cut so that when you look through the stone, instead of seeing a reflection of light like we're used to in faceted stones, what we're actually seeing is a distortion of reality. So the straight line becomes broken and choppy. And you can see in this model that I've cut, as I move it closer and further away from this line, it starts to distort and warp the line. And it even works on text. If I hold this lens cut over a book and just turn the stone, move it closer and further away from the text, you can see how it's warping the words, warping the letters. And that was really their foundational idea in this cut, was to bend light, to bend reality. Spearison even tells us in his book, this style of cutting is particularly effective on all light-hued stones such as tourmaline, beryl, amethyst, and topaz. The cut is first documented in 1950 in Spearison's book, but we are far from documenting the complete history of this cut. So the next time this cut pops up in history, it's 1952, and we've got the MDR Book of Gems, Volume 2. So this is one of the first types of gemstone design books that ever came out. This is Volume 2, and we can see stone number 14 looks a little bit similar to what we've just been looking at. So this is called the bar cut. It's not the same as Spearison's cut, but the crown is. This is exactly the same as the crown of Spearison's lens cut, but they've given it a sort of brilliant-y, princess-y type cut on the bottom. So they're kind of mixing two different styles to try and see, but you know, what can they do with this special effect? So now they're no longer trying to look through the stone and warp reality, so to speak. They're just trying to basically see what they can do with this cut. They've simplified the crown into just 6 parallel lines, and they've given it a brilliant-y bottom. Now, MDR is from California, Spearson was from California, so it seems very likely that this information is coming directly from Spearson, or directly from the community that Spearson was part of, to the community that MDR was part of in Southern California. So after the Book of Gem Cuts, we see the exact same design published in the December 1954 issue of Lapidary Journal. So we can see this is literally the exact same design. It's been copied from one to another, but through the publication of the design in Lapidary Journal, this has given the cut a chance to spread out throughout all of America and really the wider world of the subscribers of Lapidary Journal. Before, whenever it was just a Francis Spearson cut, people could have learned about it from his book, but probably not everybody bought his book at that time. But it's likely that a lot of people would have encountered this idea of these parallel lines instead of a normal crown through the Lapidary Journal subscription. And so as this issue went out all over the world in 1954, people probably started to experiment a little bit with this style. And we're gonna see that as we go on, it just keeps getting tweaked and modified and changed as we go. So our next milestone moment in the history of this cut comes in 1962. We've got the Facet Cutter's Handbook. Another very popular book. This was just really a pamphlet that a lot of cutters had. It was $6 back in 1962. So really something that wasn't gonna break the bank, something that definitely did spread all over America, because if you look online, you see millions of these used for sale today. So this was a widely purchased and widely used book. And we can see almost on the last page, the first time that we see the name Opposed Bar Cut. The book's by Edward Sukup, but in the design, it says Opposed Bar Cut, design and data by Gustav Mullen of the Mineral and Gem Society of the Castro Valley. So we're still going back to the San Francisco area, and it's very likely that whoever Gustav Mullen was probably was an acquaintance of Spearson, possibly visited the San Francisco club, or maybe they cross-collaborated between clubs. Maybe they went on a mining trip together, who knows? But one way or another, the cut has moved from San Francisco to Southern California to Lapidary Journal and back up to the San Francisco Bay Area, where we've got a new variation of it by Gustav Mullen. And this one is not exactly the same as Spearson's. It does have the same kind of effect that Spearson's cut gives us, but there's a few things that have been tweaked. The first thing that's obvious is we're no longer looking at a rectangle. We're now looking at something a little bit more like a rectangle meeting an oval. It has an interesting outline. The next most obvious thing that we see is the long parallel facets are no longer running the length of the stone, they're running the width. So Mullen has flipped the design around so that the facets are running the wide way and the pavilion side is running the long way. This is a lot more similar to this cut that we see as it is today. And of course, the effect that the stone gives is exactly the one that we find in the modern version of the cut. That pixelated moving squares, lights twinkling in that square pattern that sort of creeps in from the sides. So 1962 is really when the cut transformed into its modern version, and we do see the first time it's labeled as the Opposed Bar Cut. But definitely seeing that transmission and that evolution of the design as we move it around through time and space. So our next variation comes in 1967. Heinrich Gerald's done another version of the cut, which he posts in Gem and Minerals magazine. And here we can see he's kind of gone back to Spearson's original design with the rectangle. He's still using Mullen's variation of the short facets going across the wide way instead of the long way, but now he's kind of taken that idea that Spearson had of having those long curved facets on the side of the stone that give it the shape that it needs for the curved crown. Other than that, it's not much different than the version that we saw in 1962. And as we move on through the 80s and 90s, we see that Fred Van Sant also tried his hand at this cut, and he's published two different versions of it that are slightly different. Not much has really changed from Fred Van Sant's versions to the previous two versions that we saw, but he is obviously playing around a little bit with how many facets are on the top, using bigger steps versus smaller steps, and trying to play around with different variations to get different kinds of light patterns. So as those squares are reflecting all over the stone, he can do little tiny ones, or he can do a design with bigger, flashier ones. Now the next version of this design comes from Jeff Graham, and this is probably the one that most people encounter today when they find this cut online or in books. So this is originally coming out of his Money Cuts number 4, and if we check it out, he's got a couple different versions in here and even before. So this is 1999, this is called A Posed Step 3.0, but even in this book he's got a couple different versions. He's got one called A Posed Barrel, he's got a Diagonal A Posed, and a couple different variations that he's posted online or in his book. So in 1999, he cuts one of these opposed bars, and his version isn't much different than any version that's come before it. He's just kind of made it his own, made it slightly longer, give it a little bit of emerald cut corners. So in 1999, he cuts a tourmaline in this style to go into a piece of jewelry that eventually makes its way into an art show in the Tucson Gem Museum. Now, while it's in the show, one of the curators from the Smithsonian sees it in the art show and decides that they need to acquire this piece to go into the Smithsonian Museum. And so they purchase it, and you can see that one of these older versions of Jeff Graham's opposed bar cut is in the Smithsonian today. If we go ahead a couple more years, 2001, Jeff Graham posts another version of this opposed bar cut onto his website, but he's now changed the name to the Smithsonian Bar, likely just celebrating the fact that he now has a jewel in the Smithsonian. So he changes the name to the Smithsonian Bar, sometimes referring to it as the Smith Bar, and now we've got another version of the cut with a new name. So it could be the lens cut, it could be the opposed bar cut, it could be the bar cut, or now it can be the Smithsonian Bar or the Smith Bar cut. So lots of names for subtle variations on the same thing. So that's 2001. From 2001 until modern times, different people have played around with the cut. Of course, it's always been somewhat of a fun, popular cut with hobby cutters, but the next moment in our story of importance for this cut comes in 2019. So in 2019, Jordan Wilkins started cutting the opposed bar cut that he found on Jeff Graham's website. So I wanted to talk to Jordan and see, how did this whole story unfold? How did he start cutting the stone, and how did it eventually become a viral phenomenon?
For me, that design actually goes back to when I first started cutting a little over 10 years ago. One of the first things I did was bought Graham's books and saw his website. That's when his website was still up and published. And obviously the Smithsonian Bar was one of his free designs. And I think that was probably within the first 10 stones I cut a Smithsonian Bar. And that was the first one I did. And it actually is with Shelley in the Somewhere in the Rainbow collection now. So yeah, that was the first one I did. That's how I found it. And I cut a few more along the way in the last 10 years, but not too many, but I've always liked it. Just that pixelated effect just was always cool. And then I happened to cut one a few years ago and just posted it up to my Instagram like I do with every other stone. And just randomly, someone, I guess, who followed me posted a video of it to Reddit. And I got a link from a friend saying, dude, your stone is blowing up on Reddit. And it had over 30,000 upvotes and 2,000 comments or something like that. And then I get a message from a random Instagram page that I don't know, asking if he can use the video in one of his YouTube videos. And I'm like, sure, I don't care. And then he sends me the link to the video, and this guy has over 6 million followers, and he just posts compilations of viral videos. And within a week, it had like 6 million views. And then after a month or two, it had over 10 million. And to date, I believe a year and a half, nearly 2 years later, it's got 17 million views on his YouTube channel. And then, you know, Unilad picked it up and shared it to their Instagram and their Facebook. And then it spiraled out, just these random website started just writing articles on the pixel cut, as the Minecraft cut, as it was starting to be called from that point on. It was Minecraft cut, it was the Creeper Stone, it got so many different names, and the easy one was pixel cut. You know, your random everyday person has no idea what a posed bar means, but they know what pixels are. So it's a good way to relate it to the general public. I just call it the pixel cut because, you know, over the past 2 years, that's what the people who follow me have started calling it and know it as. When I'm talking to people in the trades, I'll call it an opposed bar or the Smithsonian bar. But when I post it, I call it the pixel cut. One of the first stones I ever cut and just happened to have one go absolutely viral. Yeah. And it changed my life. I have been consistently cutting them pretty much since then, and I sell almost every one of them I cut. But yeah, for the next year, I would say every third message I got on Instagram from a new person was asking me to cut a pixel cut for them.
So this cut's gone from very simple beginnings of a simple flat bottom stone with 8 rectangular facets on top, being used in some well-remembered and well-loved jewelry from Margaret DePatta. It's gone through many changes over the years, evolving in its design, being adapted and combined with other designs, sometimes being given new names, and finally, thanks to the wonders of the viral internet, it's gone all over the world, it's gone all over Instagram, and now we know it by so many names. It's probably the design with the most names of any design that I can think of. The lens cut, the bar cut, the opposed bar cut, the Smithsonian cut, the Smith bar cut, the pixel cut, the creeper. That's a lot of names for one effect. It's definitely a very cool effect. It doesn't look like any other type of design. It gives you a very, very unique look, which is really why this stone has been able to go viral, and also probably why it's been able to stand the test of time. It's a very unique, special effect that we don't see in many other types of designs. I also really love that this is a very American cut. This is maybe now one of the most famous American cuts. If we look at all the different cuts that we see in the industry today, this is one that has definitely made an impact on the larger, not only gem cutting community, but the jewelry world and just the general art loving population of the planet. So thanks for going on this journey with me. This has been Justin K. Prim. I always love looking at the story behind all these different cuts. So if you haven't seen some of the other videos, go check them out. There's gonna be a link popping up here in just a second to see some of the previous cuts that I've looked at. Definitely browse through my channel and see if there's something that speaks to you. If you're looking to have a stone custom cut in the opposed bar, definitely go talk to Jordan. We can do it here in Bangkok, and I'm sure many, many other gem cutters across Instagram, Facebook, and the social media world would love to cut one of these stones for you. So this has been Justin K. Prim in Bangkok, signing off. See you next time. Check you later.